The key theme of the Raisina Dialogue 2018 has been about managing disruptive transitions. One of those disruptive transitions that we're addressing in the course of various conversations here is what's happening online. Are hashtag communities, for example, challenging democracy? Are they creating narratives that are dividing people further, or are there places on the internet for people to come together and work for common cause? Joining us to talk about all this, we have with us Mira Kamdar, author, and recently left the board of the New York Times Advisory Council as well. Mira Kamdar, thanks for being with us. You write very frequently on India, on the developments of India, within India, politically, in your pieces, in your columns, and very often when you do that, there's a backlash, a volley of comments from hyper-nationalists on social media who target you for being critical. What are your views? How do you take those communities on, those people on, who troll you?
I take them on in a variety of ways. Sometimes I will address them, and often I find that they are invariably young men with 3 to 5 followers maximum who have a public platform to get some attention and get their views. Mm-hmm. Often I've been amused to have very vitriolic comments directed at me with madam. So there's an element of respect and awe even as the person is attacking me. And I think it's important to reach out to young people who may feel disenfranchised, who may feel like their opinions aren't taken seriously. They're attacking someone they feel is a big celebrity in some way, much more of a celebrity than I am, in fact. Mm-hmm. To kind of reach out in some way. Oftentimes, it's just ugly, and I just block. Sometimes I just block, mm-hmm. block. It's often enough to block one key person, because you notice they're the kind of trolling trains. It's no secret that in India in particular, or globally speaking, emanating out of India, there are these kind of troll armies mm-hmm. that have sprung up and become particularly active, I have to say, since the election of Prime Minister Narendra Modi in 2014, and seem particularly active and particularly vitriolic on the right, as opposed to on the left, where there's also a lot of comment and a lot of feedback that happens. Mm-hmm. But you don't seem to get these organized responses from hundreds of people saying exactly the same thing, which also makes one wonder sometimes, are all these Twitter accounts genuine, or have they been somehow aggregated, as a kind of blunt instrument to pummel critical comment?
And that's an interesting question that you posed. It's also one of the challenges when you see comments that are very similar in their phrasing or their wording, you wonder if it's a machine that's actually sending them out. And this issue of bots has become a huge one as well online. The challenge is, how do you, when you're balancing between freedom of expression and what is respectful, common civil discourse, where do you draw the line and how do you draw the line?
Well, first of all, if an attack goes personal as opposed against the comment or the ideas that are being put out into a public conversation, if the attack consists of threats of violence against the person, mm-hmm. My person or anybody's person who is commenting, if they get into very degrading kinds of language, mm-hmm. Again, in a personal mode, that is where you draw the line. There's a difference between even vicious public debate versus personal attacks. And when it veers onto the personal, as it often does when women are being attacked, I mm-hmm. have to say, it's yeah. a problem that women face far more than controversial male commentators, then a line is being crossed. What can be done about this? There are all kinds, there's big discussions going on. Should the social media companies regulate this kind of activity? Should governments regulate this kind of activity? You also have the whole issue beyond trolling of fake news circulating,
yeah,
right?
Right.
So in the country where I live, France, our President Emmanuel Macron is promising to put forth legislation to regulate fake news on social media and in the media in general, which has provoked a howl of protest from journalists saying, is it really the government's place to decide what is fake and what isn't? Mm-hmm. Shouldn't the solution be rather to help citizens better distinguish what is and what isn't fake news? These debates are going on. Certainly one thing, I can say two things that could help with the trolling. A full bore attack on the bots phenomenon. Make sure that every interlocutor in these very public global media of Facebook or Twitter there's a genuine person attached to that handle. That would be one thing that would be very good. A second thing is, I think that public figures have a certain responsibility, so that if someone has tweeted something of an egregious nature, personally attacking in a vicious way somebody, and there's a prominent public figure who follows that person or has somehow retweeted that person, they should drop that person. There should be some kind of, you know, I think that people who are in positions of prominence have a responsibility to set some kind of an example of decorum. I think that's all the more important in the Trump age, where we have an American president who is all but that, and who is setting the worst of examples, and that has contributed, actually, to a degradation of public debate and discourse on these social media. It's appalling. I don't live in the United States, but as an American citizen, I mean, I personally find that very appalling. And I would hope that other world leaders might try to do a little better and offer a better example of, you know, forms of responsible exchange on these media.
A lot of what you said also finds resonance in the Indian Twitter scape that we inhabit, because a lot of the people who use the most vicious vitriolic language online find themselves being followed by major political leaders or ministers in power, or, you know, even the prime minister in some cases. And yet when this is sort of brought out, it seems to go into this abyss where nobody is responding or reacting to this. You're right in saying that leaders need to set an example. But in the absence of that, what can be done?
I'm really not sure what can be done. I mean, certainly breaking up the bot armies is something that technically should be possible, and that would be a help. Otherwise, you know, one has to just kind of make personal decisions. I cope with it through blocking people, through selective engagement, and I've been okay. When people start getting tweets, as some female journalists have, very much outside the Indian context, in American or European context, where people are tweeting, "We know where your daughter is getting out of school and at what time," and you know, women journalists have just dropped participation in social media. I'm not sure, you know, I mean, I think we're in the flux of this. It's one of the themes of our gathering, this disruptive moment we're in, so we don't yet know how best to come out to some kind of ideal other side. But for the moment, we, you know, it's just, I think, beholden on all of us to behave in the most candid, genuine, and for those of us who are professionals, professional manner in these media, to cope with attacks as one can, to demand certain standards of leaders, even if they could care less, and even if their behavior is worse than even some of the worst attackers we see, we can still demand from them better. Mm-hmm. And we can still expose who they may be following and whatever. And we can also expose the circulation of hateful discourse or vicious, almost incitements to violence against particular people or particular groups or particular communities, and expose that is happening on social media and who is behind it. That's very important, especially for journalists.
And you made the point about women journalists as well being particularly targeted, and that's again something we're seeing across the globe. The kind of attacks are personal, sexual very often, or sexually violent in nature. But, you know, where do women's rights activists also make the point? Then, you know, do women hit back in the same language? Do they retreat? Because hitting back then has its own set of consequences, and you set a chain of events in motion that you may not want to participate in. And that becomes tricky.
I think it's on a case-by-case basis, and it depends on the woman involved. I mean, some people have a stronger stomach than others for this kind of thing. And, you know, each individual, woman or not, needs to engage in a way that they feel safe and that they feel that, you know, that they can engage honestly, but, you know, not get too much into self-censorship or whatever. it's always, I mean, that we live in a lopsided world in which it's the easiest way to attack a woman is always to attack her sexually.
Right.
Right. So that's just something that comes with the territory of being a public figure as a woman. And unfortunately, it's unclear yet how the hashtag movement, you mentioned the hashtag movements that has swept the United States and to a very lesser extent Europe of the Me Too, will impact any of this. There is already backlash against it and recuperation. So we're still in a disruptive moment where, you know, the idea of a woman holding a position of responsibility, being an opinion leader or maker, pronouncing on the events of the day, perhaps in a critical way, as responsible journalists do, because that is our role in democracies, is to as the fourth estate, is to make sure the public is informed and able to, as citizens of a democracy, make informed judgments about their elected leaders and when they're going to vote. And that means saying things about any government that that government may not want to hear, because our role is not to be government spokespeople.
Correct.
Our role is an oppositional role to any party or any government, really, to keep them honest. That's our job. So people sometimes don't like seeing women in that kind of a role. Especially when the ideology of the government being exposed or commented on or whatever would rather have women in the home and quiet. So you know, it becomes doubly a problem.
But you mentioned the hashtag MeToo as well, which found resonance here in India. Let's just flip it around a little bit, because while there are all these issues about what happens in social media and the way people engage, it was also a way for a lot of women to come together in support of each other, and that led to a momentum that actually got the conversation going as well. So there are positives.
Absolutely,
as well.
Absolutely. And this, of course, speaks to the positive side of social media, which on the positive side, it is a powerful a tool for democratization of information and opinion, but also to bring people together around a cause, which is, of course, why it's a medium that governments are wary about, because any medium that allows masses of people to come together around a cause makes just about any government nervous.
And finally, we started the conversation by talking about who's going to regulate, or should there be any regulation of what happens in social media. Apart from trolling, which is its own kind of hate speech that users generate, there's also another conversation going on violent extremism and countering violent extremism, and how do you deal with online radicalization. Does hate speech make the transition from just hate to radicalization? And if so, then are these companies responsible to say that enough to say that, look, we're not just platforms, we can't, you know, we are also content providers at the end of the day, and so we have to abide by perhaps some of the rules and regulations that may guide mainstream media?
Well, certainly various countries have various laws in place governing hate speech. Various countries have put into place limits beyond which one's freedom of speech ends.
Right.
India has a particular set of limitations to that. Defamation comes into play, things like that, hurting the sentiments of various groups.
Communities, right.
Okay, so this is where free speech in India meets a roadblock, outside of these media, and certainly any laws in a country that apply to expression in general, which one may challenge in the legal, you know, in the courts or whatever, if one disagrees, but still, if those laws are in place, why they should also apply to the social media space. Now we're getting into, though, a slippery kind of moment where Germany, for example, has just enacted a hate speech law, and it's been used or accused of being used in the media of pulling a site from social media that was not engaging in hate speech. And the question then becomes, who is making those calls?
Right.
Who decides this is hate speech, this isn't? This group is radicalizing, this group isn't. And, you know, we're in a moment where it's very easy for governments in illiberal democracies, especially, to decide that groups that they find too critical of what they're doing or are circulating information they don't want circulated are troubling and therefore can be accused of being, you know, inciting hatred or inciting terrorism, whatever. I mean, the best way to shut someone up in our day and age is to brand them or their group a terrorist group.
Right.
And there really are terrorist groups, of course. So there really are, there is radicalization on the internet. It is a problem. But, you know, it's just, I think, part of an ongoing discussion and job in democracies to keep discussing these things, to keep everything in the open. Transparency, openness, open debate, these are our best weapons in democracies to deal with these things.
Mira Kamdar, thanks very much for talking to us.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.